Life is a journey made up of experiences. Some are good, some are bad, some happy, some sad. We may all be different, but we are connected through the fact that no matter who we are, our stories all have hills and valleys. And so tonight, we dedicate this episode to those who get lost at sea and find their footing again on terra firma. Welcome to Sim Soul Sessions. Hi everybody, and welcome to tonight's show. We're tonight in our safe space. We're talking to, there's a man who wears many hats, but we're going to call him tonight a businessman and creative, Danar Dan Dan, Life of a King Royal. But before we do that, we're checking in with one of our season three guests, Tanania Tracy, who we're checking in with tonight to find out what she's been up to since we last spoke. And you can check in and participate in our conversation tonight by using the hashtag SimSoul Sessions. So I take my seat and I say hi to you, Tanania Tracy. How are you doing?
I am fine. It's nice to see you again.
It's good to see you too. I was checking in on YouTube. Your program has over 100,000 views at this point. Yes. Something I know that you're used to anyway, because that's your language. But I want to know how you felt. You felt very vulnerable in the moment while you were here, and you shared your heart out while you were here. How did you feel when you left, and what was the reception from your community afterwards?
To be honest, after leaving, I really did breathe a sigh of relief because I was much more nervous than anything else. Because before going into the interview, I remember telling you that I don't really like going back into the past just because I'm no longer there, and I also don't want to be known as that person anymore. But after sharing, I realized that a lot of persons reached out to me to let me know that, you know, my story inspired them. They felt connected to what I was saying. They were going through similar things, and it really was eye-opening to me because I never knew that there were so many people out there like me or going through things similar to what I went through or I'm going through, and it was...
I would ask her. Yes, we have lost her. We're going to try and see if we can get her back. Tanania was here. She spoke about issues with her parents, issues with her upbringing, choosing a different career. She went to nursing school, and she left nursing to go and open her own clothing business, and all the difficulties that came when that business ended, and then her relationship ended, and she headed into social media. So we're going to see if we can link back with Tanania. Are you there?
I'm here.
I know you're not going far. Okay. So tell me a little bit about what you learned coming out of that program, because there's a lot of introspection. You spoke about days of sunshine, days of rain. Every day is not going to be great. You had your anxious moments. Sometimes you still felt a little down and depressed. How have you been dealing with all that since? And how have you generally felt in your own body, in your own mind since that time?
I still do have my periods of anxiety. I think because not much has changed, especially with the pandemic, where a lot of things are very uncertain. Now we're losing lots of people, this whole thing about the vaccine. But I realized that focusing more on myself and on my body, so I've started working out again, just starting to get up a little bit earlier to do things that I have to do, you know, trying to take control of my life and things that I can actually control, because there's a lot of things going on right now that we cannot actually control. But what we need to do is really just change our perspective on it, change how we react to things, and that is what will let us feel a little bit better. And that's what I've been doing, to be honest.
Yeah, I'm curious. I'm going to ask you a question about your mother, because you spoke about her when you were here. You said you were 18 when you moved out, and you thought that up until the time that you were here, she did vex with you about it. So is that something you guys had a discussion about or no?
We actually spoke about it, and I have to tell you that she is actually upset with me.
It's something
I don't think she'll ever... Yes, she is. I don't think she'll ever get over it. I don't think she'll ever get over it, to be honest with you. But she doesn't harbor any bad feelings towards, it's just a story that she'll tell you. So if you meet her, Simone, she'll say, you know, I never push her out. You know, she decided to go on her own. But I mean, it's a part of the story.
Okay, one more question I'm curious about. We spoke about yourself, Rush and Rowan, and the yeah. friendship and alliance you had. You yes. surprised me when you said that the falling out, or I'm not sure what you'd call it, but the issues yeah. around the time, you said you owned them because yes. you thought you were responsible.
Yes.
I'm curious as to what happened out of that, if anything, with regard to healing that fracture?
Well, all right. So if you follow us on social media, most people would have realized that me and Rohan especially have mended the friendship and have gone a little bit further into that. We've talked about a lot of the things that have happened because that is where the falling out kind of stemmed from. Rasheen, we do speak as well. We're not as far along as me and Rohan, but that's something that we're still working on and trying to see how to navigate this new journey, because it is going to be new for us, you know, having had what we had and then now trying to discover what it can be. So it's a work in progress, to be honest. Oh. Both of them are a work in progress, yeah.
Thank you for answering that, Tanani. I really appreciate it. And so finally, tell me where you are. How is business? How are things with you? What's the outlook, even in the midst of COVID? I know you're trying to remain positive. So what's on the horizon for you? But let's start with business. How are things going there?
Things are going pretty well. I've been trying to be as consistent as possible. I have some collabs that I'm working on. I don't want to name them as yet, but I'm trying to get more into physical challenges, you know, on YouTube and stuff like that. And I also want to dig deeper in terms of what other types of content that I can bring to the space, especially now because people are taking in content more than they usually do. So I want to bring them something new, you know, something that you're not used to. So in terms of my business, that's what I'll be doing. I've actually become the new host for Chilling with Grace.
Yes.
So that's a new partnership that I have to see.
That. Yes.
Thank you so much to Grace and big ups to them, because if it wasn't for you, Simone, and coming on the Sim Soul sessions, they wouldn't have discovered me the way that they did. So I have to say thank you so much.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that. And then I have a couple of things that I cannot talk about, but, you know, they'll be revealed by the end of this year.
Awesome. We are so wishing you all that's good. You know that. Thank you for coming. Thank you for impacting so many people and for sharing so openly and so vulnerably. And we will definitely keep up on social to see what you're up to.
Thank you, Simone. I appreciate it.
All right. When we come back, we are front and center talking to tonight's guest, a gentleman who's been intriguing me for a long time. I'm so happy to have him on the set. Danar Royal, life of a king, Dan Dan, whatever you call him. Believe me, you will not want to miss this session. So come back after this, please. Welcome back to the show, everybody. Tonight's guest has always made me laugh, but do not take him lightly. Danar Dan Dan Royal is no joke. As a matter of fact, his laser focus and his serious climb to the top of his kingdom has impressed me so much that I'm so very glad to have him with us tonight. After weeks of trying, you're finally in the chair.
Give thanks.
Hello, sir.
Hi, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
I love your outfit.
It's good to see you. Thank you very much. Yeah, I love yours.
Oh,
I don't think we've ever had anybody lie outside of my dad. Yeah. Sit on this set in a jacketa.
You know, sometimes if I come out and you say I come out to you, I've come out strong.
Well, I mean, how else would you come out? Looking very handsome. It's good to have you, Danar. You walked into the studio today with an air of, I want to say it's confidence, but it's more than that. It's almost like a kingly type of thing. And I realize that's a thing about you, right? And people see you on social and they see you laugh and they don't realize that there's a lot more to Danar that I have discovered. And that is very impressive to me. I was going to ask you further on, but I want to ask you at the top. Your moniker on social is Life of a King.
Yes.
Where did that come from?
The journeys of my life. Mm-hmm. I wasn't born with a crown, but I thoroughly felt it. You know, after going through certain things, I believe that we are all kings and queens. And, you know, you walk like a king and your queen will come to you. Mm-hmm. You walk with your head up and never look down. And that just has been my mantra. And what else to say but say it to yourself?
Right?
Like a king.
Right? And we're going to talk about some of the instances in your life that made you have to kind of tell yourself that, to reinforce it. But when people meet you, when people see you in social media as an influencer, a title you do not like to claim, and then they meet you as a businessman or as a, you know, just one-on-one, as a creative, are they surprised by your layers? Are they surprised by who you really are?
I get it. You know, I've gotten instances where people say, you know, funny guy or, you know, life of a king, or king, or the Dan Dan. And then when we, you know, we start having a conversation, you know, like them say, but they don't say you're smart. Mm-hmm. But you get fooled. And I say, no, just because they have humor to me, me fool.
Right,
you know?
Right.
You know, you know this, because you're humorous, you're funny to me.
Dan Dan says I'm funny. I think I need to start a YouTube page.
You should.
All right, so let's talk about these layers now. You said you weren't born with a crown. Right?
No.
Tell me about life in Tel Aviv growing up. Mom and her sister and your siblings on one bed.
I can thoroughly recall growing up south side, Tel Aviv. Used to go with the family. Mother, country woman, you know. She first came out of the country for a better life. And she brought her family with her. Mm-hmm. Their sister them. And, you know, she met my dad in Kingston, and then everybody live up in the one, they call it tenement yard. You know, you have your one house, house them. You know, you have one set stand right there, so. And it was in that moment, in that living that life, I was, if I can remember, I was happy. Mm-hmm. You know, I was indeed happy. From only from the primary school, you know, common entrance, tear up brief in a yard. You know, me asleep edge, she asleep foot, because three or four, we have to sleep on one bed. Like, all of those things, you know, put together, develop the man you see here. Mm-hmm. And you know, I said to a lot of persons that if I could have changed it, one side of me, I said, I'm going to miss too much things. You know, some things are worth more than money, if you understand me. Being content.
Wow. So you would have gone back?
I would.
Done the same way?
I would.
Yeah.
I would.
Mackerel was my steak, you said?
Mackerel is and was.
Is still. Love still love the flash of.
Yeah, I feel my thing though, you know. You know, because you know, your teeth are still knowing out. But mackerel was my steak. Mackerel and rice. And you eat that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. But it was all we had. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you have to be grateful. Because, you know, I said this the other day that I never knew I was poor until I knew what, that rich existed. You know, I was completely saturated and content in the life that I lived.
And then there came a point when you had to move you out of Tel Aviv.
Yes.
Because of violence.
Yes, man. Tear gas. I remember it was almost like the week after there was this big incursion downtown and tear gas. And but run up and I water and all the thing. And she looked at me and she was crying. And she said, I have to leave. Mm-hmm. Them time I leave go away. Well, I'm a friend them around here, but you know, she's smarter than me. She knows, she has seen life, she knows life. So you have to just trust your mother. Well, I mean, I have no choice.
And she wanted better for her kids.
Yes.
She was a dog groomer.
Yes.
You wanted to go and help her sometimes when she was working.
I did.
She wouldn't have it.
No. Because I'm not sure of her experience with just the job and just saying with the label, dog groomer, at that time. However, she wanted better for me. So even when I tell her, I said, Mommy, I go up and start there, go up and think, which one and two times she allowed it. But when she realized that I really want to help her, she said, no, go start the class. She said, no, I don't want you to come do this with me, though. I did this so you can come do better. And I said, man, all right, then we go watch cartoon. You know? But you know, she knew what she was doing, and I trusted the process. Mm-hmm.
So you went to high school?
I did excel to high school.
Enjoyed high school?
No, did.
A little too much?
Maybe.
When we get to 10th grade, CXE subject to choose. Yeah. Where was Dan Dan?
You know, Dan Dan was fully turned. Well, let me tell you. I grew up in a school, I was class clown. Literally,
no.
class clown.
Shocker.
Can I believe it?
No.
Yeah, but because I was so engulfed with just being happy all the time, I did the minimum. You know what I'm saying, the late bloomer? I was a late bloomer. And I remember sitting on a mango tree at lunchtime, when people them say, yo, homework, you know, I did the minimum. However, when we reach 10th grade now, 9th grade for matriculating to 10th grade, you forget sign for 60, right? So me go so boom now, you know, get my paper, my look, my sister may not get signed for nothing. I mean, I say, sign for what? I say, CXC, yeah, forget that. I mean, I say, CXC? What is that? What is CXC? And they say, yes, it is. I don't know about that because I was just a ramp, me ramp and play. My mother murder me, you know. But I murder me daily because I'm rude, but me ramp and play. But I went to this supervisor and I said, listen to me, I beg you do. I can't go, my mother said. I asked her, Lord, I'm dead. So please, to make me repeat. And they gave me the option. And, you know, persons went on, friends that I bonded with went on, and then I went back. I'm in the book from then, in the book. Come yeah. I said, yeah, yeah, clearly life not easy. My team just like left school, jumping on a job, you know? But no, not at work. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I took a step back in high school.
Yeah. And so you went through high school. You went through university, and you hit the high seas, and then it started to get choppy. We're going to talk more with Dan Dan when we come back about his journeys, his life journeys, and how he's weathered the storms and ended up where he is now. Soon come. It's important to remember that soul is about tears, but it's also about laughter. Dan Dan is giving me a lot of jokes, even during commercial break, and it's so good to talk to you. I'm getting go-getter, always been, always striving for better. You knew, as a matter of fact, let me ask you, when did you know that you were shooting for the stars? When did you know that you wanted to just climb and climb and climb?
You know, I always knew I was a star. listen, like, I always knew, you know what I'm saying, believe in yourself? Mm-hmm. I believed in myself. So from high school, I remember some foreigner come to school and them give some group of students to write, you know, like stories. And my story was published. This was in like 3rd grade, 4th grade.
Wow.
And I was always the one that literally was on stage all the time. I was always the one that, you know, they call me the life of the circle of life. Like for me, I push for positivity and I push for that energy that once you have that, because I'm all about energy. But I ensure that for me, I keep my soul, I keep myself, I preserve me and just ensure that in a life just keep positive, just from a bad man. Be more from a bad man, no. From God, but if you like God talk to me and say, my child, you have a nice body. I mean, no, let's accept it.
Well, it's funny because I asked you, I know you went to CMI at the time, CMU.
Yes.
So you're a seaman. I'm going to talk about that. But in trying to just get a handle on what you do, because it's a really impressive and interesting job, I asked Dan Dan when I was talking to him, I said, what do you do? And you said,
I live.
Yes. And I was like, my mind was blown, and I said, what do you mean? And you said,
I live.
What does that mean?
Living is different from existing. To live means that you're maximizing your presence, you're maximizing your ability. You are not only impacting, you know, those closest to you, but you know that there's a purpose for you. And you know, you're venturing. There's no box. There's no shore that will contain you. So you just live your life positively. You just live everything. Live positively. Live to the best of your ability. And just live and just live and just live. And once you have that type of mindset to just to just be happy and just God put you on the earth. Mm-hmm. God put you on the earth and say, my child, live. So live and just bask in everything, the downs, the up, because there was downs and up in them times, so, and there's still downs and up. So it's all about life. And you just have to just live like how you're living now.
Boy. It's profound. I will tell you. You lived on the high seas for about 8 to 10 years.
Yes.
When you left CMI. Yes. You were walking into, obviously, at that time, what you would have thought would have been your dream job, no?
Yes.
Sailing.
Town captain type of man.
Yeah. All across the world, different mm-hmm. cultures, different countries. But hitting the high seas, you would have found your first real challenge in racism.
In racism.
Did you think that would ever in a million years meet you and greet you in stepping into your dream job at the time?
No. School didn't prepare me for that. You know, school taught me about navigating the stars.
Mm-hmm.
Taught me about reading a chart. It taught me about, you know, just doing the technical aspect of sailing. But when the moment I stepped on the ship and I was handing over, and the chief mate said to me, I think I'm gonna treat you different because you're black. And I'm gonna tell you this straight, I don't like black people. And I said, you know, I have a suitcase there. It's not like, it was like, okay, what is happening here? Me not do nobody nothing. Me just come here. So me just, all I want to do is just work, you know, get my sea time, go get my license. But that's a reality. Reality hit me. That
we don't world like your diverse. Kind.
Exactly.
He said, your kind.
Yeah, your kind. They don't like my kind. And you know, it brought me to that place. I'm like, all right, watch roots, you know. Yeah, you know me. Yeah, me know where I come from, but me never expect in a modern day civilization to have a man looking at you and tell us, you know, like a kind.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the person you have to report to,
mm-hmm.
the person that will grade you. This is the person that you wake up in the morning and come in front of every day and tell you what to do and how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, I tell you some things that that man make me do on my daily routine. Some things where if me say, you'll probably say no. I've cleaned human excrements out of a crane because of the in a bucket, like literally, I cleaned bathrooms at people, those things, man. And it was a container ship at the time. So we went to some ports that was, you know, a bit disastrous. And I was that go-to guy that they sacrificed to do those things. And I do it and ball again. Come back in my room. Literally steer upon the bulkhead, which is like roof, and just have to say, oh, I know this. I said, I eat this. I said, no, man, I know this because me supposed to wear a uniform. It's not pretty, no, but it's not it.
That's
and,
not it.
You know, I can't remember when I go on post, I'm going to call my mother and say, Mommy, we need to come off. Because I feel like they're going to kill me. I feel like. Like this Sunday, and she said, no, stick it out. I know she never said that anyway, but she said, stick it out. You know, it's soon done. You're dead for 4 months. You have 6 months left. And I said, Mommy, I tell her, it's rough. And she said, even though it's rough, just deal with it. And I said, I ball again, but me lock me eye on me. I'm going to do it. I'm going to finish it. And then when I came back, I said, I'm not going to see. But I'm a finisher. So I went back,
mm-hmm.
finished. Went back to school,
mm-hmm.
graduated, and got on a ship that the culture was different. And then I was like, okay, so this is not generic. You know, it's different. And from there, I started to move and progress and, you know, do the work and put in the work and come back home. And then
the star that he was born as, as he told you, as Born a Star, started to really, really rise. More with Dan Dan after this. Soon come. Welcome back to the show, everybody. Still here with Danar, who sailed the high seas for about 8 to 10 years. Things eventually got better, but you knew after a point that you wanted to head back to land.
Yes.
A job offer came your way.
It did.
But it came with sacrifice.
It did.
Or did it? Because as you tell me the story, it was worth what you weren't being paid. So tell me about the trade-offs. You got the job offer, but it came with some trappings.
All right, so, yeah, me did I see, me I work, you know, yeah, I make the money, yeah, I do your thing. And, you know, there was a part of me missing. There was a side of me that I felt empty. And every time I go see, I got unhappy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're working, but you're unhappy. You're leaving family, you're leaving friends, you're leaving a lot of life that existed outside of just working. So, you know, I remember one day I was in France and somebody reached out to me and said, hey, there's an opportunity here in Jamaica. I see that you're sailing, I see that on LNG ships and there's an LNG company coming there. It's nothing exists there, but I want you to come and see. So I was like, yes, you know, yes. I didn't bat an eye, yes. I said, they said, what role? They said, they let me know. They interview everything and, you know, they got the job. The job was a senior engineer at the terminal.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Did you know anything about engineering?
No, I'm not.
Okay, an engineer. Just checking. But you just bruff your way in.
I did. You see, I said to myself, self, sometime when people, you know, when opportunities come, you say yes, and then you see it.
That's right.
You learn after.
That's right.
Yeah, man. So right. I said yes, and then when I went in the terminal, you know, me I go through, and when I heard that I was senior in some, you know, my colleagues, I was like, yeah, but these guys have master degree in engineering. What's going on? But I guess based on interview and based on my background, they saw me fit to be in that position. And me I tell you the same thing. I don't know a thing, you know. But so them talk, I listen. So I listen and I listen and I listen. So I remember sometime when we say, oh, you see that, you know, in a meeting and say, you know that the valve, that particular valve by, you know, that cluster, you know, it is not working. I want you to start with that ball valve or whatever. And I say, yes, no problem. And then I go to the person, my friend, and I say, what do you think about the ball valve? You know, what do you think about the ball valve? And I say, the part cluster one, and I say, yeah, what do you think? You know? I mean, me walk and I look at the valve. I make him walk in front of me, I will go up on the valve, and then I come back, I Google the valve, mm-hmm. I read about it, mm-hmm. and then I come back and I tell him things about the valve. So I was secretly learning, and I was secretly emulating, and I was mirroring, and I got a, you know, some guys came into the terminal, and they promoted me.
Yeah.
I moved from just being in the terminal to being head of safety.
Yeah.
And then I moved from that to marine operations coordinator. So now I'm back into shipping.
Yeah.
I was like, okay.
But you're not on the ship.
No,
then.
Yes. It's
you are talking to the captains.
Yes. I'm talking to the captain.
And when you walk on the ship, the captains call you.
Sir.
Sir.
It was very interesting.
So you've come.
Yeah. What circle? It again?
Full.
What circle?
Circle.
Give sex.
I love that.
Give sex.
I love that. So where does Dan the Creative come in all of this?
Well, remember I told you that trade-off. So the fact that I came back here, I actually took a pay cut
mm-hmm.
to be working in the terminal. But I had the ability to create. I had the ability to feed that empty side of me that existed, that was hunger and thirsty while I'm at sea. And I just decided to start pushing love and pushing energy and everything that I missed there. So I was more active in my youth theater group. I'm more active with other creatives, you know, in competitions. I'm writing, I'm directing. And I felt extremely happy. Mm. I felt balanced, you know?
You were plugged out at sea.
I was plugged out, yeah. Fully plugged.
Missing too many family moments, no culture, no...
Nothing. Yeah. And I'm a patriot. I'm a hardcore patriot. I love Jamaica bad. I have many opportunities to migrate, and I said no, because I love the country, I love the people, I have everything about it. And I've traveled a lot.
Yeah.
I've been to probably over 35 countries, and to this day, no still like Jamaica.
Yeah.
But I like Dubai, but yeah. Still like Jamaica, like nowhere.
So you wouldn't leave?
I had an opportunity, I wouldn't leave.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't leave.
And being on the high seas, and having traveled so extensively, it's really opened your horizons, so you don't think limits at all.
No.
And I asked you about your views on religion, because I know you grew up
with a Christian mother.
With a Christian mother. Mm-hmm. But you say you're not religious, you're spiritual. And that has been as a result too of your horizons widening.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about why you say that.
So traveling and meeting people of different cultures and different ethnicities, different background, different religious background, I've been exposed to Muslims. I've been exposed to Christians. I've been exposed to Jews. I've been exposed to many beliefs, and I talk to them, and you know, because these guys have your back. When the ship, I think, and they may want to throw the life raft gear.
Correct.
So you know, you learn to appreciate them culture and appreciate them as a person, and I started to listen, and it's almost as if I felt that Judgment Day. Like, this is all this person knows. This person is born. This is his truth. And he's living his truth. And we just feel like the superior being that I call Jesus, that he may call a different name, and me may call a different name, is one and the same. Because, you know, it's all about your truth and just doing good and just being in that moment and in that present of living. And I saw beyond the horizons, and I'm spiritual. I think religion is divisive, notwithstanding. Being a good spirit, it is.
Yeah.
All on all levels.
Yeah, I'm sure that spirituality would have gotten you through a tough time.
It did.
At sea.
It did.
And in that moment when you were having your rough time, that's when you kept reinforcing, I am a king.
Facts. When you're down and you're there by yourself, because you're there to see, you're there by yourself, the only person you can talk to is yourself. Because, number one, English is the general language of the ship, but these persons have their own languages. Mm-hmm. And you one from Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're missing, talk to myself, self start long time.
Yeah.
Because
self answer.
Yeah. Because self is all you have.
Yeah.
And you know, I have to reinforce it and just speak truth and speak positivity in my life and say, no man, you're gonna make it. No, trust the process, you know, keep your head up, don't watch no face, just do the work, and I just preach and just push positivity into your life. And you know, being alone then had curated me to just be just positive, period. Like that's all I push.
Gotcha. I'm sure it has impacted everyone you love. The life, funny guy.
Yeah, we don't know
all
the funny
monikers
guys
that
are.
You earn from friends and family, some of whom wanted to share some good vibes with you.
Excuse me?
Yeah. So.
Over 20 years, and we have had our fair share of highs and lows. And I can say that through it all, I classify you not just as a good friend, but as a brother. And I thank you for the laughter, the good times, you know. I thank you for the bad times as well, the headaches, the disagreements, yes. And I can say that you have had a great amount of value to my life. Because you are an individual that likes to see everyone around you happy. Even if you yourself is sad, you want to see everybody with a smile on their face. And that speaks volume to your character.
Daddy, Danar, yo, brother. I don't know me knows you is a man with like try. You see, my dear, he's a man with like, he like go feed, brother. You see me? Every time you see something, you feel like you see something out of the distance. And you decide to get it. And you do it, brother. I mean, I tell you, so that is inspiring for me, my brother. You see me? I see you even inspire me a lot. And you not even know. You see me? Because me like pick things from people me like and put them together. You see me? But brother, I tell you, so, yo, you're an inspiration to a lot of people. Enough people. You don't know that. And brother, big up yourself, dog, and go and try steal. More things I got, man. More things I got come.
He's always been pretty much what you get. He's very funny. He tries to make people laugh all the time and he very often succeeds. I know him also as a person who is good with children, and people who are good with children are genuinely good people.
Just want to let you know how much I appreciate you as a friend. You know, you've always been there for me. Can always depend on you. You never let me down yet. And you've been such an inspiration. You've come such a far way. I mean, I've always admired that about you. Your drive, your willingness to help people, your the ability to always make people laugh. It's just, bro, really appreciate you. And you've made it evident that it doesn't matter where you come from. It's more about where you're going.
Many times I've seen you on sleepless nights. You have worked assiduously, you know, for whatever you achieve, you know, and what you want. I mean, you're a true testimony of perseverance, persistence, you know, and of course, I mean, it's not where you're coming from, but where you're going. You have been very impactful and very influential to the wider society. And of course, we are proud, you know, and I just want to tell you that we, myself and the family, love and appreciate you, you know, and wish you all the best in your near future.
I just wanted to tell you how very proud I am of you and how happy I am to have you in my life. You have made it that much better. Thank you so much for believing in me, for motivating me, even sometimes when I don't believe in myself. You have been there for me through the bad times and the good times. You are absolutely hilarious. You have the ability to make everyone laugh and to also leave everyone with a life tip. You are a creative genius. I don't know what's going on in your mind, but it's crazy and it's very entertaining. And I just wanted to say I love you and to keep being you, keep being unapologetically you. The sky is not the limit for you. I'm so excited to see what else you accomplish and what else you're going to achieve from that crazy mind of yours.
He who is not courageous enough to take risks will accomplish nothing in life. Dan Dan, you are a risk taker. I am so proud of you. I'm proud to tell me nervous. You are ambitious. You are action. You are accomplished. Thank you for all the laughs, for all the ups, and for helping me through all the downs. Teaching me how not to be a yamed and be grateful of the process. And bro, always remember your famous saying, trust the process.
So I know you don't like to show emotions a lot, but everybody knows that I am emotions queen. So I wanted to take this opportunity to let you know that I love you all so much and I appreciate every single thing that you have ever done for me. You have one of the most creative minds that I have ever known and you are so, so inspiring with everything that you do. You put your all into it, you put your best foot forward and I really just wanted to say continue being the person that you are and I must say God will continually bless you and prosper you for all that you have done and will continue to do.
I want to tell you how much I love and appreciate you. I'm feeling so proud as a mom, knowing that you have reached a stage in your life where you have made me very, very proud. And I just want to tell you to continue, keep your head above the water, and I'm happy for all the achievements that you have put through for the past years. And I know that there's still greater improvement for you. whatever we're doing, please remember what goes first. I love you and I appreciate you. And I am only hoping now, I am longing, I am waiting now to have my grandchildren.
With that said, I say thank you. Thank you for adding value to my life.
I want to big you up. Continue doing what you're doing. Aim for the stars, bro. Big up.
I love you, Danar. You know that too. Later. Love you. Bye.
More blessings, my brother. More love. Big up yourself. Simone, big up yourself.
What are you doing, Pa Simone? No, you don't see me face a sweat in your heart.
It's not hot, Dan.
It's hot. The room temperature.
But it's only your eyes sweating.
My eyes sweat. We don't know. Turn on the AC, somebody.
Oh, gosh.
Know.
Tell me. Vocalize.
Watch love. Let me know. Like, you know, Mr. Fred, Mr. Family. Me nice. Mm. It's nice.
Your mother, though, Dan.
Yeah, yeah. So she
has
pressure
an expectation.
Yes, the pressure in. She's pressuring me for her grandchildren, but it's not now. Not only now. It's from way back then, and I feel pressured. I'm just say, mommy, just soak up, mommy. Soak up that pressure.
The truth is, though, Dan, as we had to break, you are looking. You say you walk like a king because you're looking for your queen.
Walk like a king and.
But it's very tough to be Dan Dan's queen because your list of items to have in a woman, you are looking for your mother.
What's wrong with that?
No, I'm not saying that's a bad thing. So you're looking for somebody with nurturing capabilities, yes, and values.
Yes.
Who loves what? Tell me.
Me.
She loves you. Important.
She loves family.
Yes.
Right? She must have, she's goal-oriented, drive. She's supposed to have that sticky toeness.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? She's supposed to stand at her own feet and just be loving, caring, nurturing, and just supportive. You
so
know?
You're really at that point in your life where you don't want the dating. You're ready to settle?
Yeah, man. Doug's nice, you know, but you know you're well consistent, you know.
Oh my God. You're yeah, nice. Let's just take the break.
You're nice, you know. Oh yes, dear.
All right, welcome back to the show, everybody. Putting the final touches on our segment and on the show for tonight. Trust the process, one of your friends said. That's your mantra?
Yes, mm-hmm. Trust the process.
Mm-hmm.
With whatever you do, it may seem like right now that like, you know, you don't have the clear answers. You know, there's two roads to travel. You have to choose one, you know. When you choose it, you have to just follow the path, just tread it. In my life, I had many roads to travel, and I had decisions to make. Sea versus land, you know, she versus she, you know. You will always have decisions to make. Once you make it, just you have to trust the person and believe, say, God have you.
Mm-hmm.
Everything will be all right. And, you know, you make... Trust the process there, and then you go down the road and boom, it's the crocodiles there, say, yes, the patrols, yes, this, but it's a part of it. You know what I mean?
And so you've been trusting the process. One thing with you going through your journey is that you said even when you took that job as an engineer, you never knew anything about engineering. You just worked harder than they did.
I did.
Because you knew where you wanted to go.
Yes.
And that's who you are.
Yes.
And that's something we can all take away from your story as well.
You have
just
to.
Just work hard.
You have to. Consistently. My friend and probably can tell us, I may seem like I have a lot of free time because I'm on social media, but I don't. Every time you see me do something, it's because I have a small gap
window.
Or a small break that we need to capitalize on. At 10 o'clock in the night, so I'm sending emails. I'm, at 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm venturing on ships. And then I have to balance now, okay, this creative side that me have to feed. I'm going to feed it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Can I ask you a question?
Go ahead, dear.
Are you ever sad? Do you ever, I mean, you say
of
big
course.
Energy and you radiate positivity. That's all you push. But there have got to be days when you're like.
Yes, of course. There are days. We're human.
Mm-hmm.
We're flawed beings. So, you know, we're not perfect. Perfection is elusive. But notwithstanding, yeah, you know, when we get sad, me, but what thing I'm back made with say, stop sad, man. Mm-hmm. Happy. Stop sad. Sad no make sense. Sad no don't feel happy. So when me sad, me just stop. I'm just happy.
Really?
It's very weird. Me don't know. I don't know if people can do that. But serious thing, when me sit down, I'm near my house, I'm saying me feel down. I'm realizing, no money to make sense. Stop. I'm just get up and just do something that will make me happy. I know my triggers. I know my happiness. Mm-hmm. I go listen to music. I go dance. I you know, go watch a movie. Like, I know what my happy triggers are. So when the negativity comes, move it. I'm the fastest.
It's amazing. But that's the process of talking to yourself and talking yourself out of it. So yes. You literally have a discussion.
I does.
Self.
Self.
I see where you're going.
Another thought.
Me not go there with
no,
you.
No, no, no. Not today.
Not today.
Not today.
Not today. Yeah. Okay. So give us your secret sauce to happiness as we head into our affirmation. Those of us who want to be able to consciously choose that road to happiness and choose that path that, you know, will take us to self-fulfillment and make us feel like life is worth it, you know?
The recipe to happiness is not so easily defined. Notwithstanding, I'm going to tell you what I thoroughly believe in, and that is love for yourself. That's number one.
Mm-hmm.
So, love thyself. Just love. Just saturate yourself with just immense self. Just pour everything into you, because you can't be happy in love yourself. So you have to start from yourself.
Mm-hmm.
See, like Michael just looking at the man in the mirror. Yeah, you have to push you, lift you up, you know, motivate yourself from within, from inside, make your heart clean, you know, and from there you will radiate. Surround yourself with positive people. Energy is important. Guard thy heart. You know, the Bible says it. So you have to do it, because some people will come in your life and they will take. Be careful of the takers. I thank you, bye.
Thank you for coming to his TED Talk. And live. Live.
How could I not? Living is a must.
Live.
You have to live. Live, 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 live. If you can't live no more, live one more time. But the fact is, just understand that you have a purpose and you may not know the purpose. You may not, mm-hmm. but that's fine. I know your job to know it mm-hmm. yet. But guess what? You have one. Just trust the process and believe it and just live.
Wow. Thank you, Danar.
Thank you, Simpson.
Life of a king.
Life of
royal.
What do you call life of a queen?
Royalty. Life of a queen.
Yeah.
I like it.
Okay, love that for us.
I'm going to wear it.
Please.
Okay. Now it's time for our affirmation, everybody, to wrap up our show for tonight. Okay, so choose joy. Easy to say? How do you do that when there's nothing but doom all around you? Well, if you listen to our guru tonight, Danar, it's as simple as choosing joy. In the same way that some people choose violence, or perhaps as simply as you choose an outfit for the day, you put it on. Just put it on. Sounds too good to be true, right? Or like it can't be that simple. Well, maybe it is. It starts in here. With an attitude of gratitude for everything, small things, big things, wins, and even losses, for they all serve a purpose in our lives. So I am challenging myself tonight, and I'm challenging you watching. Let's try it. He says it can work. Let's try it. Let's try choosing happiness. Let's try changing our mindsets. Let's consciously and arduously try. I mean, I know you're thinking, what if it doesn't work? But what if it does, right? So tonight we are affirming, I commit to consciously choosing happiness. And that is our soul food for tonight on our show as well. I'm grateful to you, Danar. So happy to have had you here today. Lots of joy being radiated and a few tears. But all love and happiness from the heart. We're back next week with another story of the power of the human spirit. Until then, every blessing, and please remember to count your blessings. Night, everybody.